grace and peace to you.
All right, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. It's good to see everybody here this morning. I know it's Labor Day, and so there's a lot of people out at the lake and going off and doing things, but we're still here to worship God. As we begin this morning, there's just a couple of announcements that we have to make. First of all, Wednesday night Bible study, we're going to be doing the parable of the four soils. And that's where Jesus talked about how the farmer casts the seeds and where they fall and all the different things. We're going to take a look at those, of that parable. If you would like to join us for that, it will be, an interesting conversation to have. Just one quick announcement that needs to be made. We did have a straw poll survey. The surveys, there were 35 surveys done. 21 votes wanted to enter the discernment process. 14 said that they did not want to enter the discernment process. We're going to turn this information over to the Church Advent Council. The Advent Council will meet on Thursday, September the 15th. 2022 at 6 p.m. And so this is to give us the 10-day lag time that we need in order to announce the meeting twice and to publish it once. And I've got the publish, and I'm going to put it in next week. So it'll be published twice and announced twice. So please keep the church in your prayers as we go to this time. And there will be more information about meetings and everything else that we plan on having at the church. So please make a note of that. Put that on your calendar as a something that upcoming thing, because we will, as I said, we will be making information available about what when the meetings will be, what time they'll be, and all of that. All right. With that being said, I need to ask a person to come forward because a little bird told me it was her birthday. So, Suzanne?
You need to do something about that little bird.
You gonna get your baby gun?
Wow! Yeah. Come on! It's only a birthday!
Well, that ain't my family safe for now.
Hey, Sam, we're waiting for another donation. You'll give up the name.
Oh, yeah. Hey, that's a good thing. For another dollar, I'll give up the name. All right. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you.
Anybody want to celebrate an anniversary or need to celebrate an anniversary after being in trouble this week? Okay, nobody. All righty. Well, there we go. We have two prayer shawls to be signed this morning. The first prayer shawl is for the baby girl of Tiffany Oakley. This is one of Jason's co-workers. The baby was born 6 weeks early with Down syndrome. But the baby is off the ventilator and doing well, but we thought we would send her a baby blanket for her little girl. We don't have the little girl's name yet, so as soon as I get that, I'll let you know. And then our second one is a little bit more, struggle. Laura Root is the mother of Easton Root. Easton Root died this past, Saturday or Friday?
Friday or Saturday, Friday.
It was Saturday morning. They had to turn off the machine. So we would like to let her know that the church is going to surround her with prayers. And so we're going to give her a prayer shawl this afternoon. So if you would like to sign this and pass it on, we would greatly appreciate it. All right. We have a nice acolyte there. Thank you. There is something to be captured in this moment of worship that we can't experience in any other time or in any other situation. So let's be alive with God, let's have us experience in the here and now. Let us worship God. I invite you to please turn into your faith we sing hymnals, the black covered hymnal, to 2108, and there you will find the song, Oh How He Loves Me, and if it's comfortable to do so, please stand as we sing both verses.
Lessons
or create community, or reveal something about ourselves, sometimes to gain attention and sometimes just to lighten the heavy moment. The point is that stories are told for a lot of different reasons. Stories have the power and have an effect beyond the words that we find in the stories most times. These stories shape our experience of the world. They shape us in that world also. And sometimes stories dream of a world that could or might be. And have you ever noticed that when a particular story is really good, everybody leans in on that story and really wants to hear it again? So why did Jesus tell stories? Well, no doubt it was for some of the reasons that I've just listed. But there is something that happens even deeper when Jesus tells stories. Something beyond the words of the stories themselves. Even when those words are hard to hear. Let's face it, sometimes talking with Jesus is a difficult task, wouldn't you say? Especially when we are hard-pressed with our own issues and things that are going on through our trials and tests in our lives. Jesus has a way of getting to difficult and hard-to-hear issues quickly and easily. Sometimes it is in a story that he reveals to us our own secret sins. Other times it is an answer to a question that catches us in our blind sides and prejudices. Sometimes it is a teaching moment that we struggle to wrap our heads around. And I would say that this morning's scripture lesson is an example of one of those. Yet these are his words, words we believe have deep spiritual values in our lives. And we need to wrestle with them. Words that we need to somehow learn and to live by. So during the month of September, we're going to have a series called Having Words with Jesus to reflect on a variety of moods and meanings. We may want to argue or turn away or just plainly give up. Or maybe we really want to know, to spend time in Christ's presence, to understand and to explore, and finally, we hope, to hear and fully comprehend Christ's teachings and words to us. This is a call to listen again, even when it's more difficult, when these more difficult passages pass over our ears. We need to stop and not skip over them, but to seek to comprehend the deeper levels of which Jesus is speaking to our hearts, minds, and souls. And so that will be our quest during the month of September as we have words with Jesus. Now, we come to that time also in our church service in which we offer up prayers for those within our church family, within our community, and within the world. And this morning, if you have a joy or concern, we'd like for you to share it with us. So first of all, we have the Trey Wakefield family who are awaiting their sixth child now. Soon to have a full infield, so let's keep them in our prayers. For Tiffany Oakley and her baby, as the baby has been born with Down syndrome, but baby and mom are doing well. As I said, that Easton Root died on Saturday morning, and we want to continue to pray for his family and lift them up because this is just a horrible situation that happened. He was in line for a transplant, actually went down to Texas Children's, had a viable liver there waiting for him. They got into the surgery room. They did the surgery procedure, getting ready to do the liver transplant. Found out that his body would not have had some more complications, adhesions and stuff inside. They then closed him back up, put him on a ventilator. His parents that they would have to make a decision to turn the machine on. So
this is a very difficult time for the Root family and for the Killingsworth family. Tell me, Sherry and
Jimmy
Killingsworth, this was their grandson. They were members a long time back at the church, but we need to keep them in our prayers, because this has got to be one of the most difficult moments in their lives. Want to continue our prayers for Rebecca Taylor. There are some things going on with her, very much like what's going on, what went on with Easton Root. So let's keep him in our prayers. Ed Kozlowski, his knee is sore and it's hurting, and he went and saw a specialist, and he goes back and sees another one, or the same one.
The original one.
So let's keep him in our thoughts and prayers as they prepare to do that. We also want to keep our prayers going for Sharon Carson and for Chris Ray and Dar Marie. For those on our presence list, we want to continue our prayers. He did get a call back from one of the potential employers, so we're hopeful about that. So if you can keep him in your prayers for that. We also want to remember the Alexandria United Methodist Church as we prepare for a time of discernment, and for the United Methodist Church as the national church. So let's keep all of those in your prayers. Are there others that you would like to pray for? All right. God knows those prayers that are most precious to you, that you can only whisper before his throne of grace in times of silent meditation. So let us take that moment of silent meditation and offer our prayers to God. Let us pray. In the stillness of the moment, your Holy Spirit moves over your church, and you come once again to prepare our hearts for worship and prayer and praise. We thank you, O God, for your presence, for your abounding love poured out upon us. Open our lives to receive that gift of grace, and help us to move into being closer to you in this time, in this place. As you stirred upon the waters at creation, so stir within us, and draw us ever closer together with you and with each other, that as we lift our voices in prayer, you may be glorified as you hear our petitions. God, we thank you. We thank you for all that you have done, for sending us the much-needed rain, for protecting us from it through the shelter of our homes and the sustenance we need, for the sleep and waking of each day, for the ability to work, for the simple actions, being able to live in a day, we give you thanks and praise. This morning, as we come before you, even before we ask for prayer for these, you know the prayers of our hearts, and as they sit As they sit in our heart, Lord, you are there responding. Send your holy angels to be with those families who are experiencing great joy. May they continue to feel your presence and express their thanksgiving for all that you have done and all that you are doing in their life, and all that you will do in their lives and all of their tomorrows. Be with those families who grieve today, Lord, and we lift them to you. Encircle them in your arms of grace and comfort them in their sorrows as they grieve. Bring peace to them in their chaos and grant them your presence as you walk with them through the valley of the shadow of death. And may they remember the joy of their loved ones with memories of happier days, of memories that will give them peace. We pray for those who need your healing, Lord. And you know their needs even before we ask. Send forth your Spirit to strengthen them and to guide them, to help them in all their ways, that they may know your presence, feel your healing power within them. Protect them from all evil and all harm. Be with their loved ones and undergird them with your strength in this time. And surely, Lord, lead the doctors and nurses that will care for each loved one. Lord, we lift up the church to you and ask for your presence and your Spirit to not only undergird us in this time, but to lead us. Lead us to discern your will and not ours. To discern who you are and who you call us to be. Help us, O Lord, to remember that your love casts out all fears, and we need not be afraid, for you are there, moving in the lives of all people. Help us to be cognizant. Help us to be attentive to your will and to your presence in our lives. Now, gracious God, give us strength to pray the prayer you taught your disciples, that it may truly be our prayer this day, and that we may live by its words as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This morning we read Psalm 139. You'll find it in page 854 in your red note, and if it's comfortable to do so. 853, I have another table. 853 is where it starts. 854. All right, we read verses 1 through 6 and then 13 through 18. If it's comfortable to do so, we invite you to stand.
Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and known me.
You know when I sit down and when I rise up.
You discern my thoughts from afar.
You search out my path and my lying down, and my yet find and are acquainted with all my ways.
Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it altogether.
You pursue me behind and before, and lay your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain.
Whither shall I go from your Spirit?
Or whither shall I flee from your presence?
I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there.
If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the innermost parts of the sea, Even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me.
If I say, let only darkness cover me, and the light about me be night.
Even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as day, for darkness is a light to you.
For it was you who formed my inward parts.
You knit me together in my mother's womb.
I praise you, for you are fearful and wonderful.
Wonderful are your works.
You know me very well.
My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret,
entered with the rock in the depths of the earth.
Your eyes beheld not unformed substance.
In your books were written the days that were formed for me, every day before they came into being.
How profound to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them.
If I would count them, they are more than the sands. When I awake, I am still with you.
Oh, that you would slay the wicked, O God, and that the bloodthirsty would depart from me.
Those who maliciously defy you, who lift themselves up against you for evil.
Do I not hate them that hate you, O Lord? And do I not loathe them that rise up against you?
I hate them with perfect hatred. I count them my enemies.
Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts.
And see if there is any wicked way in me, and lead me to a way of everlasting.
Our second reading this morning comes from Luke, the 14th chapter, the 25th verse through the 33rd verse. It can be found on page 1623 in your red pew Bible. It's entitled, The Cost of Being a Disciple. And I invite you to hear anew the Word of God. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, If anyone comes to me and does not hate, hear that word? Does not hate his mother, father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and it's not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, This fellow began a building and, well, wasn't able to finish it. Or suppose the king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able, with 10,000 men, to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he's not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. Brothers and sisters, the reading of God's word, let the church say. And sorry about that last verse. There's a word in there. All right, you may be seated. Let's see if that's a misprint in this Bible. I think it is. Oh, everything that he has cannot be at my disposal. Okay, got it. Now I got it. All right. Just a moment of dyslexia. All right. Now, this morning my goal in the sermon and within this series is not to explain away the hard sayings and difficult sayings of Jesus. Neither is my aim to make things more difficult than they really are. I invite you to sit at Jesus' feet and wrestle with these words, much like the first hearers did. And I know it had to shock you when Jesus said, You must hate. That's a hard word to hear, isn't it? Like them, the earlier listeners, I invite you to try to grasp hold of the things that seem clear and contemplate what it doesn't mean to us and what it does mean for us when we hear a lesson like this. We need to give the word time to settle in us. We need to listen so that we may gain a clearer understanding of Christ's word and our individual response. I invite you to pray with me either aloud or in silence this morning as we open our lives for the outpouring of God's love. Let us pray. O Lord, how costly your words were. For they sent you to a cross to die for my sins. Open my heart, mind, and soul to receive the grace you are pouring into my life. Through your words in Scripture, may I find comfort, peace, healing, and hope. Holy Spirit, attune my life to be challenged by Christ's words, that when I leave this sanctuary, I may live them out in my daily life. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, for you are our strength and our redeemer, and let the church say.
Amen.
I think we can all agree that these words we find in this morning's scripture lessons are a little bit hard to swallow, wouldn't you say? Kind of hard to comprehend it if you want to be honest about it, right? They are! Within the text, there are several costly words and statements that Jesus makes to his disciples and those following him, and even to us today. These words are strong and speak with a definite clarity about the cost of being one of Jesus' disciples. But I think they speak with a definitive transparency of what it means to truly be a part of Christ. There's no ambiguity. There's no misinterpretation. There's no misunderstanding. No, there are just costly words. How often do we think our words are costly? I'm sure we've all said words that we wished we hadn't uttered at all, right? Perhaps they were uttered in frustration or toward someone that had nothing to do with why we were mad. And yet, they were costly to us. You know, it's those words that slip over our tongue and through our lips, and we immediately regret saying them. Maybe even regretting the way we said them. I want you to consider that all our words carry a cost with them. And we pay a high price for the cost of our words, and sometimes it can cost us very little. When we hear and read these words of Jesus, we must remember the ultimate cost of his words and what they mean for us. We are called to remember that Jesus is the Word made flesh. Okay, the Word made flesh. What does that mean? That when Jesus speaks, it's not just Jesus speaking, this is God speaking to humanity. Okay? God. Remember the triune God? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Three in one? So when we hear Jesus speak and hear his words, it is as God is talking once again to Moses at the burning bush. We find Christ's words in our music and in our liturgy. And we celebrate it. It helps us to embrace the living word of Christ when we worship and sing those songs. Jesus' words define us. They transform us into being better followers of Jesus Christ. And that's what we really long to be. This morning's lesson is a great reminder to us of that commitment. We are called be made into the disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. So I want us to spend a moment examining the costly words of Jesus. Now, the first costly word comes in verse 26. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. The Greek word here is maseo. Rightly translated, it means hate, as in the hatred of something or someone or something. Can you imagine that word coming out of the mouth of God? There it is in plain black and white, right on the page. But there's also another way in which this can be translated. And I'd like to read you that translation. It says, if anyone comes to me and does not love less their mother and father, their wife and children, their sister and brothers, yes, even love themselves less, they cannot be my disciples. We can kind of understand that a little bit better, right? Now, why do you think he says this? Well, remember that first commandment given to Moses at Mount Sinai? What was that commandment? Anybody? Come on. Big Ten, first one.
Love us.
No.
Love the Lord.
Okay, that's Deuteronomy, but you're getting there. What does it say? Thou shalt have no other gods before me. So that's what he means here. If you love something more than God, you can't be my disciple. Oh. How many times do we love something more than God sometimes? A good chocolate cake and a cold glass of milk. And we don't say thank you, God, for the chocolate cake and the cold milk. I remember that because during the summer, at summer camp, the last day or the last meal on Thursday night was fried chicken, mashed potatoes, green beans, and the best chocolate cake you could ever have in the world. It was a sheet cake, just like the Texas sheet cake. But here's what they had. They had a milk machine. You remember the old milk machines that they had the milk in bags and they put it up in there? And it just got so cold because it was right next to the refrigeration. And man, it was a heavenly experience to have chocolate cake and that cold milk. And usually it was shared around a table at 3 o'clock in the morning. We would sneak out of the cabin and go to the freezer or go to the kitchen. And there those chocolate cakes, whatever was left of the remnant of the chocolate cake from dinner. And we would eat to our heart's delight. And I've got to tell you, I would eat 7 or 8 slices. And they weren't small. They're about yay big. So, no. And man, I once said, you know, this is better than anything in all creation. It's almost as good as God. And my counselor popped me on the back of the head. Said, remember, Sam, the sustenance comes from God. And that's why you need to be thankful. Jesus would go further and he said, love the Lord your God with all your hearts, minds, and souls. In that declarative statement of those words, that statement of costly words, he gives us an opportunity to understand the more comprehensive understanding of what God is requiring of those who want to do God's will. So that was the first costly word that Jesus gave to his followers and disciples and to us. The second set of costly words comes in verse 27 when he says, anyone who does not carry his cross or their cross and follow me, they cannot be my disciple. Who? If there were ever hard words to swallow and the biggest challenge that has ever been given before in those costly words from Jesus, it's that one right there.
Would you all agree that we live in a world filled with temptations? Yeah. It's really easy to have your cross on when you get up in the morning, right? And then as you get into the car, you put it in the back seat, maybe, or maybe you set it in the passenger side seat, and you're saying, you know, this is going to be a great day, until someone cuts you off. Or someone almost causes you to run off the road. Or someone is taking their time getting down on the road, and you're going to be late. Somehow, some way, something happens in the world, and there is an intervention by the world. And if you've ever had to stomp on your brakes and you had something sitting on your passenger side seat and it flies off into the floorboard, anybody ever had that experience before? I'm sure you have. You don't have to raise your hands. But you know, that's where the cross ends up being sometimes, in the floorboard. And so when you get to work and you're rushing and you're going, and suddenly you forget to pick up the cross. And then something else goes wrong, and something else goes wrong, and something else goes wrong in the day. All the while, the cross gets further and further away from you. But we as Christ followers are called to pick up that cross and to carry it with us. Some people carry them around their necks, right? Have them on a chain so that they don't leave them in the floorboard. Some people wear big crosses. And then they go on and live other types of lives that you can scarcely see Christ in them at all. But the challenge is not to look at their lives, but to look at our lives and how we see them. We're not too harsh on our judgments. But maybe they're just going through a trial in their life, and we don't know what that trial is. So how do we overcome these moments of life? What does it mean for you to personally take up your cross daily and follow Christ? What does that look like in the everydayness? Perhaps it may be reaching out to others, or maybe welcoming the foreigner, the immigrant, feeding the poor, walking the trail of those who are in deepest sorrow, providing for the widows and orphans, or even perhaps visiting those in prison. What does picking up and carrying the cross daily look like for you? Tony Campolo writes in his book, Stories That Feed Your Soul, he shares a story of William Campbell, who is known as the Apostle to the Rednecks. And he was preaching to a bunch of these rednecks, and he said, "The time has come in your life to receive the love of Christ in your lives. When will you do it? Now or later? To fully receive God's grace, you must fully turn yourself over to Jesus and pick up your cross and follow Him. Not your preacher, but Christ alone." He said that after he preached that sermon, he got a call from a nursing home chaplain. And he said, "There are a bunch of people knocking at our door wanting to pour out love on our residents." And William said, "Let him in." Later on, he got another call, and it was from a hospital. And he said, "There are so many people out in our foyer area, it's filled. But they're wanting to pour out the love of Jesus to to all our patients. What do? Let him in.
Finally, a jailer called him later that afternoon. He said, I don't know what's going on, but there's a whole bunch of people out here, and they want to share Jesus' love and pour that love into the lives of our prisoners. What do I do? Will Campbell said, let them in. Are you listening this morning? Are you really listening? How often do you turn yourself over fully to Christ each day? Do you do it daily? Or maybe when you remember it and it's convenient for you? Or maybe only when you're in trouble? Remember the costly words of Jesus. The third and final one of the costly words that I found this week was in verse 28. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will they not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if they have enough money to complete it? Now you may say, that's kind of funny, Sam. That doesn't seem to have much merit. But the word cost is the costly word there. Why cost? It's only found two times in the New Testament, here and in the book of Revelation. Two times. I figure a word that's only used two times in the New Testament, there's got to be a reason for that. That it carries with it a weight. A weight that I cannot see or comprehend, but I do know. How many of you go to the store and you don't look at the prices, you just throw things in your basket, or you go out shopping for a new sofa and you sit in all of them, you don't look at the price, or you go out and buy a new car and you look in the car and say, yeah, this fits me, I like it, and you don't even care, just get it up, just, you know, wrap it up or deliver it or get it ready for me to take. How many of you do that? None of us. We always count the cost, don't we? We have to. Because we want to be good stewards of what we've been given. And that's why I think Jesus uses the example. Because he knows that this man has to be wise. In order for him to build that tower or grain tower, whatever it is, he's got to know what the end cost will be. What were the end costs? Jesus. You see, it's in our nature to count the cost, but what are the costs of following Jesus daily? What are the costs of following Jesus to a cross? Are you listening this morning? Are you really listening? These are costly words given to us so that we might know and that we might follow. Jesus is asking us to count the cost. Consider the radical change, the radical difference that we are called to make in our lives and in the world. So that our lives don't follow the priorities of the world, but the priorities that Jesus Christ has for us. Perhaps it's a time for us to commit ourselves to what Wesley understood these words meant. I invite you to turn to hymn number 607 in your hymnal. And at the top there, you will find these following words. I invite you to read them in silence, and then if you can make them your prayer today, make it with me. Let's be in a spirit of prayer. And let us pray. I am no longer my own, but thine. Put me to what thou wilt. Rank me with whom thou wilt. Put me to doing. Put me to suffering. Let me be employed by thee or laid aside for thee. Let me be brought low for thee. Let me be full. Let me be empty. Let me have all things. Let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to thy pleasure and disposal. And now, O gracious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thou art mine and I am thine, so be it. And the covenant which I have made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen. That's what Wesley believed the cost was. It was an everyday cost. It wasn't just said momentarily. We say it at the beginning of the year, but this is a prayer we need to learn and say it every day of the year. This is so that we can comprehend the all-encompassing prayer of Jesus' costly words for our lives. This is the challenge that Jesus is giving to us today. We must give up all that we are and all that we have in order to be his disciples. Remember our everything. Remember that everything we say has power to heal, to wound, to soothe, or disrupt, build, or destroy. Calm or disturb, strengthen or weaken, comfort or cause despair. Words are costly words. What costly words will travel over your tongue and through your lips as you follow Christ this week? Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the costly words that call us to be your disciples. Be with us in this time now, Lord, as we come before you to share your grace and your mercy and the gift of your forgiveness. Help us to truly be the church you want us to be, and help us to remember your costly words. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, let us all say, Amen. Amen. I invite you to turn to your in your hymnals to page 8 in your red hymnals. There you will find the confession and pardon. I invite you to read the prayer of confession in silence, and then if you will make it your prayer today, will you join with me as we pray it together? Let us be in a spirit of prayer. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. We have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. And now let us continue with the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift it up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
Give our thanks to Christ.
It is right. right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord,
God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and the recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, he fed the hungry, and he ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And when the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. Words that Jesus said on the night in which he was betrayed. He took the bread, he gave thanks to God, and he said, "Do this in remembrance of me," as he handed it to his disciples. And after the meal was over, he said even some more costly words. He gave thanks to God, and then he gave his disciples the cup. He said, "Take, drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ, offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of the faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and all these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever, and let us all say, Amen. Amen. The table is prepared. It is open to all, whether you are baptized or not. What we believe is that in this moment, there is a sacred gift given to you. A gift that is not ours. It is God's. And because of that, you're invited to this table to remember who God is in your life or to experience his grace for the first time. It is now time for us to come and remember the costly words of Jesus as he gives these gifts to us. These are the gifts of God for the people of God, let us all say. I'm going to serve the music team first, and then I'll ask Belinda to help me serve this morning as we prepare this time to come and receive the Lord's Supper. The gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I invite the left-hand side of the sanctuary to come forward first, to your right, and if y'all want to come forward to receive it. Please come. May his Spirit pour his grace and mercy into your lives. May you leave your sin here, know you are forgiven. And may you go forth and take Christ's costly words to share with those who are hurting, who are sorrowful, who are filled with despair. May you go and speak the word of hope and love to them. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, let us say, invite you to come forward, please, as we receive our morning offering. Let us pray. For all good gifts we have received, we come to you to return the first fruits of our labors, to give you all that we have and all that we are, Lord. So come and indwell in us anew. Cleanse us from all sin and all brokenness. Heal us and make us wholly thine, that we may understand the cost of your words. As we give, Lord, we give back to you so that your church may be furthered, not only here in this community, but throughout the world, and that we may take your word with us and speak it in whatever we say, in whatever we do. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus Christ and for the sake of the world that he loves, and let the church say, amen.
Oh.
and every thought you have, and every action you take. May you find his grace sufficient to meet all your needs, both now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and let us all say,
amen.
I have decided to follow Jesus. We're seeing the first and last. First and last. Can she hear me?
First and last.
First.
Well, sir.